Hello friends, this is Polat Yarıcı, again. And yes, I know it's been a long time since the first tutorial. In the comments of the previous tutorial, some friends even asked if I was dead. No, I am not dead. But how can I say?
I was delayed.
But I hope I can make up for this delay now. By the way, you showed more interest in the previous tutorial than I expected. Thank you all for that. In this tutorial, we will create this imaginary plant with octane. It will be a little more complex than the previous tutorial. Although this plant is fantasy or imaginary, we will assume that this plant is somewhere in the world. So our main motivation is to add realism to this plant. We will apply real-world data to some parts of this plant in relevant parts of the tutorial. Now, prepare your drinks. Take a comfortable seat and continue watching. As you can see, we will make this plant and we have a long journey from modeling to rendering. This idea was suggested by a friend named David Trevisan in the comments on the first video. I hope I could pronounce your name correctly. This plant was a work on my Behance page. In response to David, I told him that the scene was complex and if I could find a way, I will do a tutorial. And yes, David, I found a way. Almost remade the scene because of you. So, how did this flower come about? Actually, my original aim was very innocent. I wanted to render a plant. I like macro shot plant pictures. Let me show you. Here. My goal was to make beautiful plants like these. So I started out with very romantic feelings. But then, whatever happened my subconscious led me to an unfamiliar situation. And as a result, this strange flower emerged. So I wanted to be romantic, but I couldn't do it. The horse thieves hiding in the eerie shadows of my brain unfortunately did not allow this. Horse thieves? Who are they? Anyway, I will briefly mention the modeling first, and then we will move on to creating materials. Yes, let's take a look at the structure of our scene. For the lighting, I used Octane Sky and HDRI. No lighting source other than HDRI on the scene, and I used an HDRI image for this. Let me show you. This one. I found it again from hdriheaven.com. If you are going to create a scene like this, you can use any HDRI from this site. Our flower continues to exist somewhere in this forest. So it looks like a suitable environment for our scenario. Actually, I can't imagine what a flower our plant will grow on, but we will continue with this for now. By the way, let's thank Greg Zahl for this HDRI. And finally, I suggest you consider donating to the site. We have a camera with Octane Camera Tag. This is MacroShot, and MacroShots usually include a technique called shallow depth of field. For this, I choose 135mm from the camera options. These are called long focus lenses in photography. Especially in order to create such a shallow depth of field, it is necessary to place the camera at a certain distance from the subject. This is a technique that photographers often use. And I also use this technique for this plant. It's quite easy to create this depth. Select the Octane Camera Tag in the Object Manager and go to the Depth of Field option from Thin Lens. Here you will either increase the aperture or decrease the f-stop. If you increase this, you can get the depth you see. I made 100. When you increase this, f-stop decreases, so they work together. Of course, to get a beautiful macro shot in the real world, you need a quality lens. You know, this is a lot of money. But it's free here. All free. Cameras, lenses, lights, everything. I mean, it's not completely free, but Anyway, you get the idea. And let's look at the objects in the scene. There is flower. This is a large flower consisting of one piece. There is stem, which both feeds and supports the flower with stem arms. And there are also plenty of hairs. Let me show you these. Except for the cinema's hair module, all of these hairs are real geometry. I will briefly explain how I did all these hairs in the following sections. Now, if you ask whether it will be such hairy plants, it will be a good question. I mean, there are many plants in nature that have plenty of hair. Let me show you. As you can see, there are plenty of hairs in these plants. After all, our plant is an imaginary plant and it's entirely due to my aesthetic concern that is so hairy. However, all plants' hairs have a function. There are even more than one. And we can adapt this information to our plant as well. We will talk about it later. how many topics have I said we will talk later so far? Anyway, all the model you see in the scene belongs to me, and I am not a person who makes a model, loves to do it, or able to do it. But since the plant is an imaginary one, I had to do it. I watched a little cinema for these modeling tutorials, read help file, and this came out as a result. So the model you are looking at right now is the work of a novice modeler. I will explain how I made these models of the whole plant here, one by one in the next sections. But don't expect this to be like the narration of a professional modeler. No way. I will briefly share which workflow I applied while making these models. Yes, let's start with the modeling of the stem first. Yes, friends. Now I will briefly show you how I made the stem of the plant. Actually, if you know the technique, it's quite simple. And I also learned it by watching tutorials. First, I created a cylinder. I changed the parameters of the cylinder, as you can see here. And activated caps. All parts of the object must be closed, because we will use scattering and absorption in Octane. Then, I added a band to the cylinder, and bent it like this. Classic Cinema 4D workflow. So far nothing interesting. But the interesting things starts from here. Now let's make this cylinder editable. I use current state to object for this. And back this up for now. Let's select all polygons from polygon mode and check normals. Yes, as you can see, normals are fine. Let's check the points. There is a trick here. The points of the caps are normally open. As you can see, it's open. Look at the other. Yes, it's open too. But this is only a case in caps. To fix it, let's select all the points and choose optimize with a right click. In this way, all points are well to the object. In other words, the object is closed and we can easily make Octane medium for this object later. Let's choose polygon mode again. Now I will create the arms of the stem. Let me show you from the rendered picture. These ones. For this, let's choose the ring selection. I will extrude those polygons you see here. Okay? And select matrix extrude with a right click and check the options here. I have entered some settings before. These settings will look different on you. First, make the settings you want and press apply. And then you can see every change you make in real time in the viewport. You can play as you wish with these options. In addition, you can create many different shapes with this tool. And you can even forget what you are doing after a while because it looks like one of the addictive tools of Cinema 4D. Yes, stem is roughly ready. We will not leave it like that. as there will be plenty of deformation to this model. For this, I will use Cinema 4D Sculpt tool. Let's choose to sculpt here. I don't understand the quality of Sculpt software, but the Sculpt of Cinema 4D also looks very good. At least, it looks good to me. Now, some friends might think of mighty ZBrush first when it comes to sculpting. Sorry, friends. Of course, it's a matter of choice whether you use ZBrush, Modbox or 3D Core. You are the one to decide. But frankly, I didn't need ZBrush and others in this case. Also, I should tell you something. Don't mess with ZBrush unless you do Gandalf. Okay, it's a bad joke. A very nice software. Spend some time and learn if possible. If you know ZBrush, you won't be out of business in the industry. Now I'm going to stream the video fast. After all, I will not make this sculpt right here and finish it. And I will not teach about Cinema 4D sculpt either. It goes beyond the purpose of this tutorial. Instead, I wanted to show the workflow. Cinema 4D sculpt is not difficult and it's very enjoyable to work with. There are plenty of tutorials on YouTube. You can watch it there. In the next section, I will briefly explain how I made the flower model. Yes, friends, let's make the flower model of the plant. So I will make the part here. It's easy. There is a spline profile in the scene. Let's see in the front. I created this profile using the pen from the options here. By the way, does this look like the Nike logo? I sıçayım. I also drew badly. Anyway, call it a subconscious accident. However, I have nothing to do with things like Nike. I don't even wear shoes. Anyway, let's continue. Now select the spline and select the latte from generators. As you can see, I made a pot. But this pot will be a flower a little later. Let's look at the parameters. From here, I am doing subdivision 30 so that I have better control when I sculpt. So I am narrowing this range. And let's make the spline points uniform for optimization purposes. I recommend paying attention to these options when dealing with splines. Now let's make this object editable and choose the current state object again. For reference, let's rotate the flower minus 90 degrees. Again, let's check the polygon normals of the flower. And yes, as you can see, normals are completely wrong. To fix this, choose reverse normal with right click. To be able to sculpt, these normals must be correct. Otherwise, sculpt cannot be done. And finally, let's look at the points again. Select all and optimize all of them. Yes, the flower is now ready to sculpt. Let's open the sculpt workspace again and start sculpting on the flower. I am also quickly going through this sculpting process because I followed the same workflow as the previous stem. The important thing here is that after making the base model, you decide how to deform it or what it will look like. So actually the most struggling part is this sculpting. It's also the most enjoyable one, believe me. Therefore, sculpting is the most important parameter in all these processes. Yes, in the next episode, we will look at the setup and modeling the hairs. Yes, friends, let me tell you briefly how I did the hairs on the plant. There are two ways to do this. At least I know two ways. One of them is Cinema 4D's hair module. After all, you need a simulation for the hairs. You can't do it manually. Actually, you can, but you have to be insane enough. Or you have to be someone who likes to suffer. And believe me, nobody wants to suffer when it comes to 3D softwares. And the second is to use a plugin. Let me talk about the hair module first. My knowledge and experience about hair module is limited. I just use it for very simple things. I haven't done a complicated setup before. But in order to make the hairs on this flower, it is necessary to use the hair module at the level of mastery. You will create hair for your object and modify it a lot. You will spend a lot of time on both the material side and the setup side. So I did not use the hair module on the whole plant. I made a very simple hair setup, especially for adding details on the plant. However, using hair module requires experience. You know, no simulation is easy. You have to practice a lot and you need to know the tips and tricks well. So, hair module is demanding. It has a complex structure by nature and it can be a little difficult to set up in complex jobs. If you spend enough time and show patience, you can do very nice things in hair module. But in this tutorial, I used plugin rather than hair module. We have two options for this. One is commercial and the other is free. Let me show the commercial first. Ornatrix. Believe me, I practiced a lot to be able to say that name. It looks like a highly detailed and functional plugin. I did not use it, so I will not comment. It's a nice plugin according to my spice. If X Particles comes to mind about particle in Cinema 4D, the same may be true for Ornatrix. And the nice thing is that it has also Octane render support. This is a commercial option and there is a trial version. But I used a free and old plugin. The name is Ivy Grover. You may have heard of it. A simple plugin. It creates ivy on any surface. That's it. It may not be compared to Cinema's hair or Ornatrix itself, but it's quite simple and fast. Now let me show you what this plugin does for you. I choose a starting point in my object with a double click. And then I click on Grow Ivy. And the plugin starts building ivies to the surface. This process is sometimes done with real time and sometimes with delay. But after a while, you can see the ivies. Let's choose stop for now. As you can see, the plugin has created ivy splines, which is very natural chaos on the surface. Now, if I tried to do a hair setup for this, I would probably be doomed. But with this plugin, I was able to do hair in a very short time. That's why plugins exist, to save lives. To use this ivy, let's select branch spline from the plugin's bird tab and click on Give Birth. And so the first ivy is ready. That way, it's quite easy to create different ivies for different parts of the object. However, this plugin has a disadvantage. It has no longer support. I think it was last updated in 2017 and its support stopped after that. So you may need to do some hunting on the internet. Maybe you can try your luck on Cinema 4D forums or plugin sites. That's how I searched and found it online. Also, I am using R19 versions of Cinema 4D and in this version, the plugin works fine. But I don't know if it works on versions after that. Maxon made radical changes after R19 in Cinema 4D, so the plugin may not work in the latest versions. Now, let's say you are satisfied with this result, but it may take some optimization rather than using as it is. There is a lot of point crowding here, and if we use them as they are, the render time will increase. So these points need to be reduced. There are several ways for this. For example, you can select all the points and select the round with the right click. After you enter the setting you want from here, your point number will decrease. As you can see here. But in this process, you need to pay attention to the level of detail. The other way is to delete some points. You can delete points that are not in your view or too many adjacent points. Since the plugin creates a nice chaos, a minor deletions will not be a problem. After these operations, you can modify the points. For example, you can select the magnet with right click and pull the points as you wish. As I said, do not forget to do this deletion and reduction on the basis of points. So, of course, you may not do all of these, but optimizing everything you create is a good habit. In short, that's point optimization. But do not think it's an easy process. It will take your time and you will deal with these points enough. Now, let's make these splines to polygon. We will not leave these splines as they are. They will be polygons. Let's choose the spline here and select sweep from generators. Then let's create a profile and make its radius to 0.1. And assign it to sweep. Yes, our polygon hairs are ready. We will do another optimization here. Let me show you closely. As you can see, there are many subdivisions. These are nightmares for every render engine, so we have to reduce them. For this, let's change the intermediate points to 50. As you can see, the subdivision have decreased. And yes, that's how I made the hairs on the plant. I made different IVs on different parts of the surface. I also created a spline from the surface and used the spline feature here. In this way, I was able to better distribute the IVs over the entire surface. In short, you can use this plugin as you wish, if you can find it. Yes, it's a nice and fast plugin, but don't expect to do complex things like Cinema 4D's Air Module or Ornatrix. They are not even in the same class. I used this plugin because it's suitable for my scenario. Yes, the modeling session is over. We will create materials for our plant in the next sections. Yes, friends, we begin the most enjoyable parts of this tutorial, creating material. I feel more comfortable already. At least I am glad to swim in the waters I know. Before we start creating material, let's take a brief look at the plant-light interaction. At least we create a foundation for our plant. Now you know the plants. I mean crazy organisms, right? Let me show you. You see? They have a complex structure. It's such a strange system that it starts from the wavelengths of the light, uses carbon dioxide and water to extract oxygen and sugar as byproducts after incredibly complex processes. You know, we have to respect such a system, and we owe our lives to such craziness. So, let's thank our plant friends for this complexity and all these efforts. We hope that they continue like this. But what matters to us is not this internal complexity or chemical processes of the plants, but how they interact with light. We will have to talk a little bit about that now, with a diagram. Yes, the diagrams in the previous tutorial are also available in this tutorial. Did you think I forgot? No way. Yes, now you all know this electromagnetic spectrum. Very familiar. This range is a tiny one that we see in the huge spectrum. In fact, if you consider how big the spectrum is, it's a pity that we can see such a small range. I don't know, it will be a good if we saw some ultraviolet and some infrared with the naked eye. Come on, nature, do us a favor. Plants also use this range quite a lot, including infrared and ultraviolet. Let's say what we call color is actually a wavelength or energy, because each wavelength has a certain energy. Plants use this energy, so they are dependent on wavelengths. Now, when we look at plants that are so light dependent, we see these three things at once: absorption, reflection, and transmission. Everything we observe in nature has these three features, and it happens at the same time. This part is important and true even for matter that has the most reflective properties. But depending on the structure of matter, we see them at different ratios. The names of these ratios are absorbance for absorption, reflectance for reflection, and transmittance for transmission. What we see is actually these ratios, okay? The most visible one is absorbance, which is very natural because all plants want to use and absorb light at maximum efficiency. We also see reflection rates, which is diffuse reflection rather than our classic specular reflection. While plants want to use light efficiently, they also do not want to reflect the photons. This is common to all organic structures. Imagine that we all reflect like metallic surfaces. Nonsense. Absurd. And thirdly, transmission, which is the common feature of all light transmitting structures. Plants have a moderate transmittance rate. Some plants have a high transmittance rate, but this is not high enough. Which makes sense too, because plants want to use the energy of the photons that enter them and keep them inside as much as possible due to the many complex components in their structures. As a matter of fact, the transmittance rate is not as high as a glass or bottle. Photons cannot just pass by when they enter a plant. In short, these three features work together in plants at the same time. As I said, we see different rates. Yes, after this boring lecture, let's take a look at how these three features are used in our plant. We may need this information while creating the material. And, of course, I will explain on a new diagram. There is no escape from these diagrams, I tell you. The first material I create will be for the flower. As you can see, this flower is green. That means this plant is doing photosynthesis. A plant like this can do photosynthesis? I don't know. Maybe it is. You know, this is a useful plant. Maybe you can cook and enjoy it. This flower has chlorophyll A and B pigments. These two pigments are present in all of the green plants that do photosynthesis. The green color you see is the result of these two pigments absorbing different wavelengths. I will explain in more detail when I'm making this material. The material type for the flower will be specular material and octane medium. I will also benefit from absorption and scattering when using medium. The material for the stem will be as in the flower, but this time there is a different pigment for the stem, carotene pigment. Since it's a different member of the very large pigment family, carotene absorbs different wavelengths. That's why this yellow color is formed. In nature, the stem colors are almost the same as the colors of the flowers, but there are plenty of examples that are not so. And there is a real-world explanation for this. I will also talk about this while making stem material. Finally, we will use specular and octane medium for this stem. Hairs are a little different. Normally, the hairs protect the plant from many factors. For example, they protect the plant from overheating because of their high reflective properties or other environmental effects. They even protect it from evil insects. Yeah, evil insects. So, the material I will use for... Sorry, friends. So, the material I will use for the hair will only be specular reflection and transmission. I could also use absorption and scattering for hairs, but it will not be efficient in this scenario. These two effects of such reflective hairs will also be negligible. And for a technical reason, I cannot use absorption and scattering medium for hair module. I will explain this in the following chapters. Yes, we analyzed our plant and talked about what kind of material we will use. After that, we will make use of some real-world data during material creation. Since we live in the age of realistic render engines, I think we should pay attention to these data, no matter how abstract or imaginary this plant may be. It's a good thing, good habit, that we still adopt some real-world information for it. Now, after all this talk, it's time to apply this knowledge to practice. If you are ready, we start the first material creation with this flower. Yes, let's start the material creation with flower. For this, go to materials and choose Octane Universal from here. I will explain why I use it, but before that, let's assign this material to our flower. As you can see, we have a perfect metallic flower. You know what? If plants behaved this way in real world, we were all hungry. We were all dead. Fortunately, that's not the case. We will fix this. Before that, the UVs of the flower in the scene, or rather the whole plant, are not UV unwrapped. Unfortunately, I don't like unwrapping the UVs. In fact, I don't like was a bit of wrong statement. The truth is, I am not someone who can unwrapping or mapping the UVs. In my opinion, there is no such thing as UV. I ignore it every time. I don't know why. Obviously, I have a problem with this modeling thing and everything else involving model making. Actually, I did modeling on this project. I even did sculpting and enjoyed it. But I still cannot be fully convinced about this modeling process. Is there a psychologist specializing in 3D problems? I just need a few sessions. However, I have a lot of respect for the persons who deal with these jobs. I watch with admiration wherever I see a master modeler or someone who's sculpting. Anyway, I didn't UV unwrapping of any objects here, as I wouldn't do any meaningful texture distortion anyway. But you, don't be like that. Make your UV maps of your objects, like a professional. Now, I am selecting cubic here and closing the UV topic. Let's open the node editor and get to the material. First of all, why did I choose Octane Universal? First, because Octane Universal is a material that is extremely flexible, enjoyable to work with, and covers all other material types and options. Second, I want to add some texture variations on the flower, so I want to use albedo here. If it was just specular material, let me show you. Here in specular, I don't have a channel to do that, or I don't have an albedo or diffuse channel. So I would have to make a diffuse material just for this, and then mix these two material with mix or composite node. Yani, this way seems very ancient to me now. I am a simple man and I use Occam's razor at many points in my life. If the same result will come out, the simplest way is the best. In this case, while Octane Universal meet all my needs in a simple way, I no longer use this ancient method. Anyway, let me delete these horse thieves immediately and get back to the topic. Horse thieves. Stupid. Now let's make the simple settings first. Activate fake shadows from common and give our material a name. Flower? yes, very creative, Polat. Now we need to get rid of this metallic feature as soon as possible. This feature is turned on by default in Universal Material. Since this material includes the properties of all other materials, it is inherently dual in nature, both conductor and dielectric. In short, conductor materials are materials with high electrical conductivity, so their reflection is high and transmission is low. For example, gold, copper, steel, in short, all metals. Dielectric materials, on the contrary, have low electrical conductivity. For example, wood, glass, rubber, all plastics. It's actually a very broad topic and potentially a future tutorial, maybe. Maybe. Here, we have to make this distinction when working with universal material. The question is that our material will be conductor or dielectric. It is obvious that it will not be conductor or metallic, since we will create plant. The material we want to work with is specular. So we need to set this universal material to a specular property. For this, let's first make a float value of metallic top to zero. Then let's go to the albedo channel and set this V value to zero. And finally, let's go to the transmission channel and stop here. I want to turn off a few things on the scene before I explain transmission. Let's close that stem. Just focus on the flower. And also, the scene is a little dark. We can enlighten a little bit. I have made some settings in camera imager before. I activated these so we can see the scene better. Let's go back to the node editor. Now, since the universal material is metallic in default, the transmission value is zero. So our flower does not transmit any photon. It swallows them all, like a black hole. In fact, let me show you better this situation. Go to specular and change the float value to zero. You see? Now we will change this by setting a value for transmission. What did I say about our plant? It should be absorption, reflection and transmission. So let's give transmission a value. For example, 80. And also increase specular, say 0.35. And yes, we have a specular material now. Moreover, it's ready to use with all other material options. That's what I meant when I say flexibility. This is the beauty of universal material. Now, let's start working for the flower and making a setup for the absorption and scattering. Let's assign the scattering node to the medium channel. Density is too high. Let's make it 15. We can also make step length to 5. Also, let's deactivate the invert absorption. If this is active, the color you enter becomes the color after all other wavelengths have been absorbed. So you see the color that is not directly absorbed. I won't do that here, so I turn it off. Now, let's assign an RGB spectrum node to scattering. This is a thick-leaved flower, assuming that there are many components and particles in it. In this case, the scatter rate will be relatively high. Let's do this 60 for now. And look at this phase setting. It will be better to say scattering direction for this phase option. As general information, the scattering direction will be forward in organic substances. In our flower, the scatter direction of the photons also will be forward. So in the example here, the light is coming from here. In this case, our photons must move about this direction. This is called forward scattering. Let me explain this situation with a diagram. Now, the light comes from this direction, these regions. As soon as the photons enter our flower, they start scattering. Since the scattering direction in organic substances is forward, they will scatter in this direction. So they are going to scatter in the direction of the light. This is called forward scattering for short. If they scatter towards the light, it's called backward scattering. And finally, isotropic scattering if there is even scattering in all directions. Okay? I mentioned this topic in the previous tutorial, but it's worth reminding. Let's change this phase value to 0.45 for now and stop here. As you can see, there is a minimal effect here. Why is that? Because there is no absorption. We observe this scattering effect minimally without absorption. Remember, absorption, scattering and transmission work together. As you can see here, we see the scattering effect at a minimal level. Now, let's leave this phase like this and adjust the absorption settings. We will go back to this phase option. Now, before I make the absorption settings, let me explain which wavelengths this flower absorbs and how it takes its color over a, guess what, diagram. Don't make your face grimace. These are important. We have to understand some things. Anyway, let's open the diagram and render the picture together. What did I say? This plant is green. And green plants all do photosynthesis. There are A and B chlorophyll pigments in their structure that make this happen. These two pigments specifically absorb two separate wavelengths, as you can see. The peak point of chlorophyll A is mostly in the violet-purple region. That is, it absorbs this region the most. Chlorophyll B absorbs the blue zone. And finally, both pigments most absorb the red zone. This region is the region they absorb the least, this green, yellow, orange region. Since the photons in this area are the least absorbed, these are the photons coming out of the plant. So, green in our case. This is why green plants look green. The carotene pigment here is for the stem, which I explain later. Now let's use chlorophyll B for our flower and set up on octane. Now let's add two RGB spectrums. One mixed texture. And finally, let's add a float node. These two RGB spectrum nodes are for the color values. And the float node is for controlling the mixes of these colors. Now, let's connect the nodes. And finally, link the mix texture to absorption. Now we can enter values for absorption colors. Let's enter the blue zone first. For this, I have data that prepared before. And let's enter the red zone. And green. You see? All the characteristics of the flower suddenly changed. If you ask why this happened, when photons penetrate a medium, the first thing done is absorption, and then scattering begins. Of course, since this happens very quickly in nature, we see all at the same time. This is the basic principle. And octane simulates this situation very well. Of course, there is more technical and mathematical complexity behind this. But as a result, octane produces a very good result. Very nice of you, octane. Very nice. So, blue and red are absorbed here. In this case, the least absorbed color is green. Let's look at it again from this diagram. As you can see here, We absorb these two regions as a result. And we obtained the least absorbed green in this region. So the real world data works fine in Octane. In short, we are on the right track. Let's enter a value for float node. Look, when I play with it, the color changes. For example, green becomes orange. So we can even obtain the carotene pigment because carotene is also absorbing these regions. Okay? Now, let's enter 0.37. And leave it in this color for now. I hope I could explain what I wanted to tell. This is a good example of how scattering and absorption work together. Also, we can see forward scattering better right now. For example, if we make the phase setting negative, that is, if we do backward scattering, see, photons scatter towards the light. Now let's change that to 0.35. Yes. By the way, in recent versions of Octane, they added a feature called random walk to this scattering section. Since I have a version 4.05, I don't know how this feature works. But as far as I understand, a more realistic scattering can be done in this way. These are nice developments. Octane is getting better. I remember when it first came out. It's a... whatever. Maybe I will have a chance to try this feature one day. Now, we have a reflection problem to deal with. Let's fix it. As you can see, there is a strong specular reflection here. Plants in nature do not behave this way. Maybe with some exceptions. Let's look at the examples. Look, for example, how did this plant behave here? It absorbed as many photons as possible, and the photons coming out were scattered due to the indentation on the flower surface. So, there is diffuse reflection rather than specular reflection. Let's look at the other example. As you can see, the same situation here. There is diffuse reflection. In short, plants do not waste energy of light, which is very precious to them, by making a strong reflection. Here, the current specular reflection needs to be more diffuse reflection. So, this reflection will be distributed across the surface. I will use roughness and normal for this. For now, let's reduce the reflection here, for example, 0.2. Then add one RGB spectrum. No, it's not RGB spectrum. Delete! Image texture, yes. And connect to this roughness. Now, I will use texture for this node. Let me show you where I found textures. Every texture comb. A very nice sight, some may know. There are a lot of free textures here. When I say free, I mean it's not royalty, but textures that you can use both commercial and personal. Moreover, with their maps. I found all the textures I used in this tutorial. For example, let me write plant as the search word. Let's choose this one. As you can see, you can download the map you want from here. Okay? Now, let me assign here a texture. By the way, there are some tips and tricks for texture usage in Octane. You can read them on the forum. Yes. There is an obvious pattern here, you see? This pattern can be reduced with the transform node. Let's add one here. And enter 4 to scale. and enter 07 for the X transform. Yes, at least some reflections have been blocked. However, it's still not at the level I want. These reflections need to be even more distributed, generally scattered across the surface. I will use normal channel for this. Actually, what I am going to do is create something called microfacet on the surface. In real world, all surfaces are essentially uneven, no matter how smooth it looks. Actually, the surface is uneven in microscale. All photons that come into contact with such a surface are scattered according to the structure of the matter. This is the difference between diffuse reflection and specular reflection. In render engines, this is called microfacet theory. This is a long topic and I will not mention it for now, as it will have to be explained together with BRDF. If you ask what BRDF is, let me show you here. These ones. In fact, these are very useful functions for creating realistic material. So, why didn't I use in this tutorial? Actually, it will take a long time to explain this. So, let me continue our main topic. Maybe one day I can make a detailed tutorial for BRDFs. But for those who are curious, I also mentioned them a little in the Cinema 4D Octane manual. You can read it from there. Now, let's add another image texture node. And also add a transform node. Let's assign a texture to it. And link this to normal channel. Change power to 4. And from the transform node, change the scale to 6. Yes, as you can see, those specular reflections at the beginnings are gone. We got more diffuse reflection. If I had used BRDF, I wouldn't actually have to deal with them because the microfacet function is included in Octane's BRDF models. But let's do it this way for now. BRDF is the story of another time. It's a long subject. By the way, those nose-like things are firefly. They are seen more especially when you use specular material. There are three ways to eliminate or reduce them. Let me show you. You can increase the sample here, which doesn't work in some cases, but this is the first way. Secondly, you can play with the GI clamp here. When you decrease this value, the firefly decreases a little more, but do not decrease this too much. This value varies according to the type of the light and material you use. I gave 4 only for this scene. But for example, I even use 50 for some scenes. Because in this option, you actually determine the bounce amount of photons. And the bouncing photons lose their energy after a while. For example, the number 4 in the scene means the photons do not bounce too much and they quickly transfer their energy with each bounce. After all, there is no magic number for this. And the third is to decrease hot pixel removal from camera imager. I don't recommend less than 0.5 because the details disappear and the rendering starts to look bad. By the way, HDRI images also produce firefly because of their EV values, also known as exposure value. Generally, this value is high, especially in outdoor HDRIs. Therefore, HDRI images with high EVs produce quite a lot of firefly when they contribute with photons. In short, you can decrease this GI clamp when using HDRI. And interestingly, this firefly issue seems to have something to do with BRDF. I especially suspect specular material and default Octane BRDF. Because Octane's new BRDF functions also obey the law of conservation of energy. That is, photons lose their energy in case of an interaction. However, in the default Octane BRDF, This is either not happening at all or only partially. Which seems to be a reason for fireflies. Maybe. So this is my theory and I have already started working on it. Anyway, it's a long topic as I said. And maybe one day we will talk about them. Yes, we solved our reflection problem. As a final touch, let's add a texture variation to this flower. I will use albedo channel for this. And now let me do this setup silently and you watch it. I have spoken a lot and I am tired. I may have ruined your brain too with my ugly voice. Now I mute my own voice with a nice sound of rain. Peace of mind. Oh be, how about if I do the tutorials as no commentary? You will get rid of both my ugly voice and my lousy accent. And I will be spared from talking so much. I don't know, it's not a bad idea. I'm going to think about it. Anyway, the setup here is pretty simple, just to create the texture effect you see here. I added a little more fine detail to the flower. Doing this, is optional. You can skip the step if you want. But all the beautiful things are the sum of the little details. Or not. I don't know. I am not a philosopher. I have set the gradient effect here before and save it from the save preset. Then you can choose it from the load preset. That's it. As I said, it's very simple setup. At least there is no need for complicated setup in this scenario. Yes, we finished our flower material. A lot of fine tuning can be done for the setup here. You know, this fine tuning is an endless subject. If you remember, I named it Fine Tuning Inferno in the first tutorial. Anyway, let's leave it for now and move on to our next material creation. Now, let's have a look at the material of the stem. I say let's have a look because this time we will not create this material from scratch. Since I have applied almost the same workflow with the previous flower material, I will briefly talk about the ready-made material here. There is no point to extend the tutorial duration. Now select the material and weave it from the node editor. This time I only used specular material, not Octane Universal. Because I didn't make texture variations on my stem. Again, as you can see, I used roughness and normal to distribute reflections. Let me show you what the stem looks like without these. You see, there is a strong specular reflection. And it looks like an alien plant on another planet. You are guaranteed to die as soon as you touch it. However, stems in nature, with exceptions, do not behave this way. They hold water and minerals in their structures and use light efficiently. Let's look at our examples. As you can see, there is no specular reflection, only diffuse reflection. Let's look at another. Same here. So, let's reconnect our notes and make the stem diffuse reflection again. In absorption and scattering, I applied the same workflow as in the previous flower. Our absorption colors are different this time. Let's look at our diagram again. Stem has carotene pigment, and here are the two regions where this pigment absorbs the most, the blue region and the cyan region. If you mix the colors of these two regions using float note, you can get this yellow color, as you can see here. That's all about absorption. In this scenario, it has no different use than the previous flower. In scattering, I increased the amount a little this time. The stem is thick and there will be many components inside such a thick stem, and photons will scatter throughout all these components. In other words, in such a thick stem, photons will start scattering in all directions immediately after absorption and will come out from all directions again. In this case, the amount of transmission and scattering will be high, depending on the density. Also, I did forward scattering again, but this time I kept the scattering direction minimal because there should be scattering towards to the arm extent. So we can say more like isotropic scattering here. Yes, friends, that's all for the stem material. In the next section, we will create the material of hairs. Yes. Now, let's make the hair materials of the whole plant. But before that, let's talk a little bit about these hairs briefly. Now, our plant is quite hairy. I have previously shown that there are plenty of hair plants in nature. However, we will not see that much in the final render for our plant. Let me open the render image here. I did not want to see much hair in the final render, so I kept the index and transmission of some hairs a bit high while making materials. Some are low, and I made it look like this. Although it may seem a bit arbitrary, we have an explanation for this. In some plants, the hairs can be dead, or in some plants, the dead and ally hairs can be together. In dead hairs, the index of refraction is very low. That is, the light goes through without much bending. On the live hairs, you can see a higher reflection, index and transmission value. And you can see a results like here. I will show these during material creation. There is a hair group covering the whole flower on the scene. I did this with the Cinema 4D's hair module. It's a very simple setup. Let me show you. First of all, let's make those polygon hairs invisible. So just focus on the hair module. Rather than doing the whole flower, I selected some polygons of the flower and assigned it to the hair. Then I gave this value from count. Warning, the more you increase this, the longer your render time. Because when you assign specular material to such hair, the rendering time naturally increases. And I also used hair material options for the irregularities for the hairs. I used frizz and kink here. Except for the first four options, you can use them easily because they interfere with the geometry of the hair. Octane allows this because of the object tag here. I did all other hairs with the Ivy Grower plugin that I mentioned earlier. Yes, Now let's start making material with hairs of this hair module. First, I switch to the close-up camera. I also decrease the depth a little to see it better. For example, 50. Now, select the specular from materials and assign it to the hairs. Set the projection again cubic and let's set the render region to give faster results. Now we can look at the examples of plant hair in nature and decide what kind of workflow we will follow. Yes, what did I say? Plant hairs are reflective. That is, their most obvious visible feature is that they are reflective. The reason for this is that they protect the plant against overheating. And it does this by reflecting back some of the light coming on the plant. Look, I say some, because it should not be understood that it has a metallic feature. No. The hairs also have high transmission properties. Otherwise, the amount of light coming to the whole plant would be too little and ultimately the plant would die. Plants with hairs have elevated these two traits almost to the level of mastery. They have a wisdom within themselves that we still cannot understand. Anyway, look, as you can see here, both reflectance and transmittance rates are high. We will create the following effect in specular material by giving roughness. Let's open the node editor now. Select our material and activate the fake shadows. From reflection, let's change its default value. It's too high. For example, 0.58. And make the roughness 0.02. Then let's go to the transmission. Enter a color value. And stop here. Now, I have to explain why I did this. In fact, I never use transmission to give color when making translucent material. It is the absorption that determines the color of such materials, not transmission. Transmission determines the light transmittance in a substance. So, actually, what I had to do was use absorption, exactly like this flower or this stem. And the first condition to use absorption is that you have an object that consists of polygons, and that polygons must be closed all over. However, the hairs in this hair module are not real polygons. They are all parametric. So, I can't use absorption and scattering. Turning the hairs here into polygon and putting them back into a model is rather cumbersome process in Cinema 4D. As I could not use absorption for these hairs, I had to use color from transmission. And this is wrong because of technical limitation. Actually, it's not a technical limit, but you don't want to do some actions in Cinema 4D. And this hair module is one of them, believe me. So why did I use color values from transmission? Because I don't want the hairs to be completely white. Let me show you. Make those first two values to zero. You see? However, I want the hairs in this flower to be in harmony with the environment a little more. Let's enter the old values again. Yes, actually, that's it. We don't have to make such complicated setups at all. If we have knowledge of the optical properties of any substance, it's up to you how you use it. For example, there is absorption and scattering in the hair of plants in nature, which I could use this information. But I did not use absorption and scattering because of the hair of the hair module is not a real polygon, and the clumsiness of making them real objects. which I tried before doing this tutorial. And frankly, I could not see any significant difference. Moreover, the render time has increased unnecessarily. Why is that? Because there are two main optical properties in HAYES, transmission and reflection. Especially if you think that both are high, you get the following conclusion. In fact, let me explain it to you again with the help of a diagram. I promise this is the last one. Look, this HAYES has a high reflection feature. In this case, some of the photons are reflected back, and other photons that penetrate the HAYES quickly leave the medium due to the high transmission. Of course, it still does absorption and scattering, but those two are minimal. Their energy transfer is very short, and they pass without encountering any obstacle. When we look at the HAYES in these pictures again, we can see that they are all white. Why? Because there is almost no organic component in the HAYES that will specifically absorb light. This English language is very interesting. I don't even think this HAYES is interested in energy of the light. Naturally, absorption and scattering happens at minimum levels. This is all because reflection and transmission are high. Because of the function of the epidermis cells, that is, its task to is protect the plant from the heat and some evil insects, thanks to the HAYES. These epidermis cells have already taken their energy from other processes, and it will be an unnecessary effort for the HAYES they are responsible for to absorb light and use energy again. I repeat, even these HAYES do absorption and scattering, but at a minimal level. And despite these high rates of reflectance and transmittance, the HAYES do not constitute almost any obstacle to the plant's photosynthesis. Really crazy creatures. I hope one day we will find the theory of everything and understand why these crazy friends behave so complicated. Then the excitement of everything will disappear, but anyway. Yes, that's all about the HAYES material. Now I will adapt it to other HAYES by copying from this material and changing some of its properties. Of course, I will not do this here. I will do it in the background. Wait, I will be back. Yes, I made the HAYES material variations and assigned them to the others. What I do is change some of their reflection and transmission values. Then, as you can see here, I randomly assign to the models. That's it. Now let me talk about the render time of this scene. With the rendering options here, it took 50 minutes on NVIDIA 1080 Ti. Yes, it sounds too much, unfortunately. The reason for this is the parametric HAYES of the HAYES module and the specular materials used in the scene. Look, it's not polygon HAYES here. They are all parametric. As you can see, there are exactly 10,000 pieces of HAYES and specular materials are used in all of these. So this causes a long render time. By the way, the rendering time of the other polygon HAYES is much shorter. Specular material is a render-heavy material in its nature. That is not just the case with Octane, but the general situation with all render engines. So when you work with specular material, you have to consider long rendering times. However, you can make some optimizations. For this, there are some settings from the render settings. Let me show these. First of all, you all know that the number of samples affects the rendering time. Before making the final rendering, you can quickly render small parts on the Liveweaver using the render region here and observe at least which range of samples will be sufficient. For example, this flower gives good results in 4,000-5,000 sample intervals. Second, You can play with the specular depth here. I gave 25. That's because I use absorption and scattering. This value also depends on what and how you will use it on the scene. Third, increase the parallel and max tile samples here. If you have a new generation GPU card and a lot of VRAM. These two options speed up the renderings a bit. And finally, you can play with adaptive sampling here and spectral AI denoiser settings from the camera imager. I skip these two, as the explanation is long. There are good explanations for both in the manual and YouTube. Of course, what I am saying now depends on what type of GPU you have. For example, if you have new generation NVIDIA cards, the render time will be considerably shorter. Even better, if you have a few of these generation cards in your system. Unfortunately, I have only one 1080 Ti. I am quite archaic, both in terms of equipment and software. An upgrade is a must. I even need to upgrade myself, but I am not sure if I can pay for it. Yes, friends, before I finish the tutorial, I want to talk about one thing. I want to continue these tutorials without long breaks anymore. However, it takes a lot of time to prepare this type of tutorial. Research, setting, and narrating. But I'm not complaining. I really enjoy doing this, and I want to be my main job. But if this is going to be my main job, I have to leave my current job. So I intend to open a Patreon account. I would also like to hear your opinion. Guide me. How should be the reward system? Or how should the pricing be? I am absolutely confident that I will post tutorials on YouTube for free, but I need a working model to generate revenue from Patreon as well. I am waiting for your advice on these matters. And yes, the tutorial is over. Thank you if you have been patient and watched this far. I don't know what will happen in the next tutorial, but in the previous tutorial comments, a friend suggested that I make a foggy forest. Maybe I'll do that. Who knows? Bye bye.